The challenge facing many countries today is how to get enough energy to satisfy the growing demand. Fossil fuels and nuclear plants are options but come with a lot of headaches. However, a new form of energy production known as thorium reactors promises to save the day. What are thorium reactors, how do they work, and which companies are involved in the development? Join us as we take a deep dive into new thorium reactors that can change everything. There is no economy without power. This is why the world's leading economies are constantly scrambling to increase their energy production. When it comes to energy production, there is often an ugly side effect – pollution. For example, in 2019, almost two-thirds of global electricity came from fossil fuels, while nuclear energy accounted for 10.4%. Coal, crude oil, and natural gas are all considered fossil fuels because they were formed from the fossilized, buried remains of plants and animals that lived millions of years ago. Because of their origins, fossil fuels have a high carbon content. Using fossil fuel to generate electricity comes with many problems, which many countries are trying to run away from. For instance, unearthing, processing, and moving underground oil, gas, and coal deposits take an enormous toll on our landscapes and ecosystems. The fossil fuel industry leases vast stretches of land for infrastructures such as wells, pipelines, access roads, and facilities for processing, waste storage, and waste disposal. Coal, oil, and gas development pose a myriad of threats to our waterways and groundwater. Coal mining operations wash acid runoff into streams, rivers, and lakes, and dump vast quantities of unwanted rock and soil into streams. Oil spills and leaks during extraction or transport can pollute drinking water sources and jeopardize entire freshwater or ocean ecosystems. That's even before talking about emissions. And fossil fuels emit harmful air pollutants long before they're burned. Indeed, about 12.6 million Americans are exposed daily to toxic air pollution from active oil and gas wells and transport and processing facilities. These include benzene, linked to childhood leukemia and blood disorders, and formaldehyde, a cancer-causing chemical. When we burn oil, coal, and gas, we drive the current global warming crisis. Fossil fuels produce large quantities of carbon dioxide when burned. Carbon emissions trap heat in the atmosphere and lead to climate change. In the United States, the burning of fossil fuels, particularly for the power and transportation sectors, accounts for about three-quarters of our carbon emissions. And fossil fuels emit more than just carbon dioxide when burned. Coal-fired power plants single-handedly generate 42% of dangerous mercury emissions in the United States and two-thirds of U.S. sulfur dioxide emissions, which contribute to acid rain and the vast majority of soot or particulate matter in our air. Nuclear energy comes with its own baggage as well. The Fukushima nuclear disaster is a testament to that. This disaster was a consequence of a tsunami and a powerful earthquake in March 2011. Although the chain fissile reactions were shut down automatically in response to the earthquake, the tsunami damaged generators responsible for cooling the plant's reactors. Without cooling, the components of the reactor's core can literally melt from all the energy released from these reactions. In this case, they did. Radioactive material was subsequently released along with several chemical explosions initiated by the immense heat released by the nuclear reactions. Also, the waste generated by nuclear reactors remains radioactive for tens to hundreds of thousands of years. Currently, there are no long-term storage solutions for radioactive waste, and most are stored in temporary above-ground facilities. These facilities are running out of storage space, so the nuclear industry is turning to other types of storage that are more costly and potentially less safe. In addition to the significant risk of cancer associated with the fallout from nuclear disasters, studies also show an increased risk for those who reside near a nuclear power plant, especially for childhood cancers such as leukemia. Workers in the nuclear industry are also exposed to higher than normal levels of radiation and, as a result, are at a higher risk of death from cancer. There is also the problem of siting nuclear reactors. Nuclear plants need to be located near a water source for cooling, and there aren't enough locations in the world that are safe from droughts, flooding, hurricanes, earthquakes, or other potential disasters that could trigger a nuclear accident. The increase in extreme weather events predicted by climate models only compounds this risk. However, a new technology promises to change the face of energy production forever. It is the thorium reactor. But what exactly is thorium? Discovered in 1828 by the Swedish chemist Jons Jakob Berzelius, thorium is named after Thor, the Norse god of thunder. It is a slightly radioactive metal found in trace in rocks and soils worldwide and is particularly abundant in India and the state of Idaho. Thorium has only one major isotope, thorium-232, and its others only exist in minute traces. This isotope eventually decays into the lead isotope, lead-208, but what makes thorium attractive is that thorium-232 can easily absorb passing neutrons, turning it into thorium-233. This new isotope, in a matter of minutes, emits an electron and an antineutrino to become protactinium-233, an isotope of protactinium. With a half-life of 27 days, this then converts into a uranium isotope called uranium-233. Thorium reactors do not need water for cooling. The molten salt nuclear reactor, which runs on liquid thorium rather than uranium, is safer than traditional reactors. This is because the molten salt cools and solidifies quickly when exposed to the air, insulating the thorium so that any potential leak would spill much less radiation into the surrounding environment than leaks from traditional reactors. Instead of using fuel rods, molten salt reactors work by dissolving thorium into liquid fluoride salt before sending it into the reactor chamber at temperatures above 1,112 Fahrenheit or 600 degrees Celsius. When bombarded with high-energy neutrons, thorium atoms transform into uranium-233, an isotope of uranium that can then split, releasing energy and even more neutrons through nuclear fission. This starts a chain reaction, releasing heat into the thorium-salt mixture, which is then sent through a second chamber where the excess energy is extracted and transformed into electricity. The waste products of uranium-235 nuclear reactions remain highly radioactive for up to 10,000 years and include plutonium-239, the key ingredient in nuclear weapons. Traditional nuclear waste has to be housed in lead containers, isolated in secure facilities, and subject to rigorous checks to ensure that it doesn't fall into the wrong hands. In contrast, the main byproducts of a thorium nuclear reaction are uranium-233, which can be recycled in other reactions, and a number of other byproducts with an average half-life of just 500 years. Because of the advantages of thorium over other nuclear fuels, Chinese government scientists have unveiled plans for a first-of-its-kind thorium nuclear reactor. The prototype reactor will soon be completed and will pave the way for building the first commercial reactor. The location of the first commercial reactor will be in the desert city of Wuwei, and the Chinese government has plans to build more across the sparsely populated deserts and plains of western China. The new reactor is a part of Chinese President Xi Jinping's drive to make China carbon neutral by 2060. China currently contributes 27% of total global carbon emissions, the largest amount from any individual country and more than the entire developed world combined. After the 2-megawatt prototype has undergone tests, China plans to build its first commercial thorium reactor. Measuring only 10 feet or 3 meters tall and 8 feet or 2.5 meters wide, the researchers claim it will be capable of generating 100 megawatts of electricity, enough to provide power for 100,000 people. Still, it must be paired with other equipment like steam turbines to make usable electricity. Apart from China, another company called Natrium is also working on a thorium reactor. Natrium plans to build a pilot plant in Wyoming in the US. The company is backed financially by billionaires Bill Gates and Warren Buffett. Thanks to the abundance of thorium in India, companies there are also building thorium reactors. The types of thorium reactors include advanced heavy water reactors. These are reactors where the neutrons are slowed down or moderated by heavy water, which is chemically identical to ordinary light water, but the hydrogen atoms are replaced by deuterium, which is hydrogen with an extra neutron. Cooling is by light water naturally circulating in a pool driven by gravity. Let's hear what you think of thorium reactors in the comments section below.